Well, hello, this is Peter Combs from Bidamount.com and P.O. Combs Asian Art. And we're going to get another video in before the big auctions start next week in New York with the Sotheby's, Bonhams, and Christie's. And today I wanted to take a look at the catalog called Inspired. This is a Sotheby's sale. It's really an interesting sale. And it's the collection of Gerson and Judith Leiber. And many of you may know that Judith Leiber was a renowned handbag designer for many, many years. She and her husband immigrated to the United States after World War II, and she founded basically an empire of one of the most important handbag designers in the country. But she also had an absolute fascination with art, and one of the things she was fascinated with was, of course, Chinese art, and this is the catalog. And if you flip through it, one of the things I noticed about it is that the old days, when they did auction catalogs, they would lay them out like this, and they would often place and display the items. They'd do a bid on the collector, and then they would show the introduction, here they are. But they would display them in this way. And some of them, they've gone even back to doing these vertical displays of Chinese porcelain, which is rather interesting. The Leiber family built a museum in the East Hamptons of her handbags and of her art collection. And they're quite exceptional. Ooh, coffee just came in. Thank you, Brad. And here are some of the pieces. And there's a number of great pieces in the collection, too. There's quite a few of them. She has a couple of pieces that came from the collection of Augustus the Strong, pieces she bought from the Chait Gallery, and a number of other top collections around, and also at Sotheby's over the years, too. Here's a picture of the Leiber Museum. And there was an exhibition done there of their Chinese art collection. Here's the Leiber Museum website, and you can go there. And the items in the auction were all exhibited there, and you can click through them. And this is one of my favorite pieces in the collection, was this really great Ming Dynasty Fu Lion. And there's other objects, as you can see. The thing is auto-scrolling on me here. Let's close that out and get over here. Here's a couple of pieces that are in the sale. This is a pair of giant Famille Rose Yongshen period, known as Font Hill soldier vases from the famous Font Hill collection. And there they are in the original collection. And come over here, and here they are. Excuse me, the Qinlong, not Yongchen. Excuse me, Qinlong, but barely Qinlong. Very close to Yongchen period. And they're going to be sold with a $250,000 to $400,000 estimate. And as you scroll through the catalog, here are a couple of plates that came from the Augustus the Strong collection. There's some fabulous Kangxi pieces in here, some nice sleeve vases. And on and on. She had a very good eye. This was a pair of vases that she bought from Ralph Chait Company in New York many years ago. Beautiful looking vase. And here's a nice pair of Kangxi sleeve vases and so on. And one of the things that was my favorite in this collection is this Ming Dynasty, probably Wanli, giant incense burner in the shape of a Fu Lion. Okay, it is around a foot tall and it carries an estimate of 60,000 to 80,000. And we'll see how they do. But it's a terrific catalog and beautifully illustrated. And there are things in there also that are buyable if you don't have an endless wallet. there's some lots in here that are estimated in the low thousands. This lot of three amber-colored vases are estimated at 500 to 700. So you might want to take a ride over to the Christie's, Sotheby's website, rather, and maybe get some information. There's a lot of things in here that are buyable without being a millionaire, which is really a nice thing these days. Because often these big auctions, that's all you get to see are things, for the super rich. So take a look. Some good objects in there. And then we're going to wander over to here. This is the Sotheby's other sale, Important Chinese Art. It's a great catalog. The cover lot is this fabulous Shang Dynasty bronze. We'll get to it in a minute. It's estimated at $1.5 to $2 million, but with that, it's a wine object for serving wine, and it'll probably do very well. Here it is, and they did a lot of photography on this. Obviously, it's an important piece. There it is. It's a great big wine vessel, and if you blow it up, you can get a good sense of the surface and patina on it. This is actually the catalog on our website that I'm using, but you can go to the Sotheby site and see the same pictures pretty much. All right, and As I said, it's estimated at $1.5 to $2 million. It came from the Hung Jung collection in Beijing in the 1950s, and then moved from there. Okay, and the other piece that's in here, this is a really interesting lot. This pair of vases, these are vases that are attributed to Tang Ying, who was the famous supervisor of the imperial kilns at the end of the Yongshen and into the Qinlong period. And they're very unusual. These were not made, they believe, for the imperial court. These were made perhaps as gifts to his friends. And if you look at the shape of the vases, they're very atypical. They're not at all what you expect. And they're beautifully inscribed with the Tang Ying seal on it. There are other items out there they compare it to that are floating around. And this is an extremely unusual lot. Okay, and these are really quite something. I'm not sure how big these are, but you'll notice the incredibly fine decoration of the trees and the way that the birds are done, just superbly decorated all the way around. There they are, and they're estimated at $200,000 to $300,000, and they're big. These things are big. They're 16 inches tall, great big pair of vases. And I wouldn't be surprised if they went through that estimate, because these are extremely rare. And I was actually a little surprised by the estimate. It seemed rather low, all right, because there are not a lot of pieces around that have his seal on them. And then the other thing that caught my eye in this was this really beautiful painting, exceptionally well done, and it's dated to around 1629. It's carrying. It came from the Yamanaka Company originally, and has an estimate of $600,000 to $800,000. This really fabulous, great big Buddhist painting, and here it is. And at the top, you have these massive, overscale Ming-style dragons. This is late Ming period, and the let's see here. It'd be 16. I'm gonna scroll over just for a second. Bear with me here. 1629, Zhongzhen, the second year of the Zhongzhen period, all right? And but at any rate, here it is. And it is a very typical Ming Dynasty, these lotus blossoms, these large, very elegant lotus blossoms floating around it with these two massive dragons. They remind me of the dragons that were on that big piece of cloisonné that the British Museum did a few years ago, and they had a book out with a big dragon on a piece of cloisonné. And this is later than that bronze was, but very similar. And here you have all of the immortals and all the figures going down it. Just a spectacular piece. And it's estimated at $600,000 to $800,000. And I suspect it'll probably get right up there. It's a major piece. And then there's the Jinya Tang collection. And this is a small catalog. It only has about four or five lots in it. But it's spectacular quality stone carving, Buddhist carvings. And the photography in here is just superb, really beautiful. So come and enjoy the catalog. One of the things that all of these catalogs now have is they're doing a lot more writing in them than they used to. They're writing long papers. There's a section we're going to look at in a little bit that has a bunch of writing in it by Bob Mowry, who was the head of the Fogg Museum at Harvard University. He's now consulting. He's a brilliant scholar, especially on Song and Jin Dynasty things. And this book, this catalog, has a long write-up. This section's written by Regina Crowell, and she goes into great detail about the history and the importance of these sculptures and where they came from. And but just really great photography, and you can get a sense of it. And if you come over, you can blow it up and get a good close look at everything. All right, and these pieces in here are extremely rare, and they're estimated, you know, in the hundreds of thousands of dollars each. But it's worth the education just to come by and read them. Okay, so take the time to do that. And then on to this catalog. This is the Linyushanren collection. All right. And there are a number of notable pieces. It's about a 40-odd lot sale. There's not a lot of pieces in it. But this partridge feather bowl on the cover is gone into in great detail. It came from one of the Bernat collections and is extremely rare. This is believed to be the only bowl of its type in private hands still in the world today. There's a couple at the Fogg, the Palace Museum, and so forth, but none of them in private hands. And we're going to mosey across to here. This is another piece that's in the sale, and this is a really, really fine Northern Song carved ding peony dish. It was originally brought over by C.T. Liu. It's got a fairly long history of ownership, and it's estimated at $400,000 to $600,000. And here it is on the Christie site. And I want to blow this up so you can get a good look at it. This is a superb imperial example. Notice the carving. This is incised, carved, and then glazed. It's fired upside down, which is why it has a copper rim that's been applied, which would have been unglazed. But the quality of the carving on this, if you magnify it the way they let you now, is just absolutely incredibly fine. All right, and it is, like I said, it's estimated at $400,000 to $600,000. And then moving over here is another, is a piece from the Bernat collection from Eugene Bernat, Mr. and Mrs. Eugene Bernat. They were legendary New England collectors. He and his brother Paul and Helen Bernat. Eugene and his wife collected early pieces primarily, and Paul and Helen collected the very top of the Qing market. Many years ago, back in the 80s, I guess it was, Sotheby's had an auction of the Helen and Paul Bernat collection of Qing porcelain. It had some of the finest Qing porcelain in the world that had ever been auctioned, just spectacular. And this is part of the Eugene Bernat collection, which was equally as good, but of earlier wares. And this was one of the pieces. The Bernats made their fortune in the woolen industry. They owned giant woolen mills here in Massachusetts. Really quite something. But this is a bowl that's in this auction with the dragon in the center and beautifully glazed, absolutely perfect condition. It's got a Qilong on it, and it's estimated at 60 to 80,000. And that seems fairly reasonable for that. We'll see if it doesn't get through that estimate. With that kind of provenance, you never know. But this is really the main event of this piece. This was a nice long article that was written by Bob Mowry about this particular bowl. This is an extremely rare partridge feather sung bowl with a black glaze. Actually, these aren't actually black glazes on these, just so you know. They're actually brown, and the brown is so thick that it actually appears black. And this is this piece is actually made from porcelain. We're going to go back over here for a second. And if we get in here, they provided some fabulous images of it. This is a russet splash bowl, and there's the foot on it. Okay, that's high-fired porcelain done in the Song Dynasty. And you can see where some of the glaze ran down just a little bit, touched the foot, but just unbelievably well glazed. This is a beautiful, beautiful example. We'll go over here to this one so we can blow this up. All right, here's the bowl itself, okay? All right, and there are the markings running out to the rim, and you'll notice that the rim is glazed. This bowl was not fired upside down. These bowls were fired on their feet. And so you can see right here where the brown glaze ran thin around the rim just perfectly. And an unbelievably rare piece. This is an estimate on request item. So I expect it to bring, you know, who knows, anywhere probably from maybe three or four or five to $10 or $15 million. Nobody really knows. It's got a long ownership history, major collections, lots of provenance, and like I said at the beginning, the only one in private hands. So if you're a major collector in the world and you really want to own one of these, you're going to have to pay dearly for it, for the privilege. Okay. And this was something I wanted to point out. This was something that came up on the forum this week. Somebody posted something about butterfly, Republican period butterfly bowls, and I put up an image of a butterfly vase that's in the Sotheby's sale coming up, the Jerry Tang collection, with a beautiful Kangxi butterfly vase. And I made the comment that I hadn't seen butterfly vases or pieces earlier than that in enamel. Well, I guess we really haven't still, but this is one. This is a Jin Dynasty piece, and I'd never seen this before. You see something new every day. This is a Jin Dynasty piece with black butterflies on it. Very unusual, really, really unusual. It's estimated at 40,000 to 60,000. And this is also in the Linyushanren collection. So it's quite a catalog, and I urge you to go over and go through it, enjoy it, and read it. There's a lot to read in there, okay? And that's sort of the rundown on what's coming up. And we'll try to get another one out for Bottoms, too, because they have a couple of nice sales coming up as well. Hopefully we'll get to that in the next day or two. All right. And in the meantime, thanks for visiting. And have a good week. And sign up here if you haven't. Leave a comment. And give us a thumbs up if you can. All right. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.